We saw in a previous video that turmeric is one of the top 5 anti-inflammatory food components according to the Dietary Inflammatory Index. Most people would have heard of the many health benefits of turmeric, and in this video, we'll take a look at how turmeric could reduce chronic inflammation and the risk of cardiovascular disease, a few interesting studies that explore ways to increase the body's absorption of the active ingredient in turmeric, and 5 tips on how you could maximize the benefits of turmeric in your diet. Hi, I'm Chung, an accredited nutritionist with a master's in nutritional sciences, here to share with you the latest evidence-based findings on healthy eating and living. Turmeric has a long history of being used in both Ayurvedic and traditional Chinese medicine and is used extensively in South and Southeast Asian cooking. The active ingredient in turmeric that has gotten a lot of airtime is called curcumin, which you've probably heard of as well. The only problem is that research has shown consistently that curcumin is very poorly absorbed by the human body. So, how does turmeric and curcumin exert their health benefits if this were the case? In this video, we'll take a look at a few interesting studies to try to answer this question. But let's first take a look at what the research says about turmeric's effect on inflammation, as well as a couple of CVD risk factors. This meta-analysis of 52 randomized controlled trials showed that supplementation with turmeric or curcumin could reduce the inflammation marker of CRP by 0.58 mg per liter compared to placebo control groups. What about turmeric's effect on risk factors for cardiovascular disease? This second meta-analysis of 13 randomized controlled trials showed that turmeric or curcumin supplementation could reduce LDL cholesterol by 9.83 mg per deciliter, a clinically meaningful amount. And this third meta-analysis showed that turmeric or curcumin supplementation could increase flow-mediated dilation, which is a measure of how well your blood vessels are functioning, by a substantial 1.64%. So, if the active ingredient of curcumin is poorly absorbed by the body, how did these health outcomes come about, and what could we do to maximize the benefits of this amazing spice? Let's take a look at a few studies to answer these questions. Something I mentioned in previous videos is that beneficial nutrients, for example, isoflavones in soy foods, are better absorbed when they are in their natural food matrix. And it appears that this is the same for curcumin. This interesting study got 14 healthy male participants to eat 4 different test meals on separate occasions, and the curcumin levels in their blood were then measured over the following 6 hours. The 4 test meals were: first, a control meal without any turmeric or curcumin; second was a test meal with freshly grated turmeric; the third test meal contained turmeric powder; and the fourth test meal contained pure curcumin. And the second to fourth test meals each contained the same amount of 400 mg of curcumin. The results were quite staggering. At their maximum levels after consuming each test meal, blood levels of curcumin in participants after consuming fresh and powdered turmeric were about 25 to 45 times higher than after consuming curcumin extract. The researchers also suggested that the turmeric essential oils that are part of the natural food matrix could be one factor that increases the body's ability to absorb curcumin. However, if pure curcumin extracts are so badly absorbed, why do so many randomized controlled trials still show beneficial health outcomes when pure curcumin supplements are used? Before I dive into another study that might shed some light on this question, if you've learned something in this video, help me hit the like, share, and subscribe buttons and turn on the notifications. And if you've not already done so, you could also check out this other video where I dive into another food component that is great for reducing chronic inflammation. So, why do pure curcumin supplements still seem to exert positive health effects even though they are so poorly absorbed? Let's take a look at this other interesting study that may answer this question. The study proposes that because curcumin breaks down quickly around neutral to slightly alkaline pH levels, which is what we would see in our small intestines and blood, the breakdown products of curcumin could also be the molecules that are producing positive health outcomes measured in studies. For example, ferulic acid and vanillin, 2 products from the breakdown of curcumin, actually has 3 times the anti-oxidizing power of curcumin to sweep up free radicals in our bodies. One last question we want to answer is, what does cooking do to curcumin? This study showed that boiling turmeric for 10 to 20 minutes caused a loss of curcumin of about 30%. This loss seems to be mitigated to about 15 to 20% when the pH of the solution was made more acidic by adding tamarind, a common ingredient used in South Asian cooking. So what we are seeing here is that heat applied during cooking could cause curcumin to degrade, but we also have newer research that we have just discussed that seems to show that the breakdown products from curcumin could also be beneficial in terms of conferring positive health outcomes. So, how should we make sense of these three interesting outcomes, and what are five tips to maximize the benefits of turmeric? Before I go into that detail, if you've not already done so, help me hit the like and subscribe buttons and turn on the notifications. And if you enjoyed this video, help me share it with just one other person. Given the research outcomes that we have just discussed, the following are five tips you could take note of if you are adding turmeric to your diet. Number one, based on the global average and standard deviation in the Dietary Inflammatory Index, to enjoy the maximum anti-inflammatory benefit of turmeric, one should consume about 3 grams or about 1 teaspoon per day of ground turmeric. Number two, we saw in an earlier study that the turmeric food matrix helps our body absorb a lot more curcumin. So obtain your curcumin from turmeric and not from supplements. Number three, curcumin is a fat-soluble and not a water-soluble molecule. So as with all other fat-soluble nutrients, include other fats in your recipes when you're using turmeric. This is usually not an issue since most traditional recipes employing turmeric would have some kind of fat or oil in it as well. This is another reason why you should not be taking a plain curcumin capsule with water, since most of it is probably going out the other end. Number four, to further help with the absorption of curcumin, an old study from 1997 that is often cited showed that adding piperine, which is found in black pepper, helped to increase the absorption of curcumin by 30 times. There does not seem to be newer research to verify this, but my take is that it probably doesn't hurt to add some black pepper to whatever dish you are making that has turmeric in it. Number five, given that curcumin seems to break down in the cooking process, try to keep the heating process that involves turmeric to less than 20 minutes. But as we also saw in a study today, newer research is suggesting that the breakdown products from curcumin could also be conferring healthful outcomes. So until more conclusive research is done, you could add turmeric later in the cooking process to prevent it from being heated for too long, or trust the cultural wisdom of South and Southeast Asian cooking and fry it with the oil and aromatics at the beginning of the cooking process. And before I get to some bonus content, tell me what you think in the comments. Do you think we should avoid heating turmeric for too long? Or do you think it's fine to keep to traditions and fry it with the aromatics? As a bonus, I'll also like to share a simple recipe based on a traditional Indian drink called haldi doodh, or nowadays called golden milk. It was traditionally made by boiling milk with turmeric, as well as other spices such as cinnamon and ginger. But I found that you could also use soy milk in place of regular milk and get another anti-inflammatory boost from the isoflavones from soy milk. I'll drop a link in the description where you can check out the recipe on my website. I'm Chung from Nutrition Domus, and if you're keen to find out more about one-to-one functional nutrition counseling, where I support clients on issues with their gut health, immune health, and cardiovascular health, do head over to my website, nutritiondomus.com, and sign up for a free strategy session. In these other videos, I'll explain what is chronic inflammation, as well as do similar deep dives into some of the other anti-inflammatory food components from the Dietary Inflammatory Index. Check them out now, and I'll see you next time.